Poor Jared is next. The Jared Goodell Show continues next. Goodell Show continues next. Or get him online at 1370WFEA.com. Jared, listen on demand at 1370WFEA.com. Jared is next. Jared is next.
Debate last night for the Republicans. They just keep getting better. I was afraid that without Jeb on the stage, there would be no fighting. But there was. We've got the sound bites for you. Plus, a terrible attack in Kansas last night, killing three, injuring 14 others. It's finally Friday morning. This is the Jared Goodell Show. What a nightmare. What a nightmare. I'm not talking about last night's debate. I'm talking about my morning this morning so far. well, for those that don't know, I commute in from Keene. I live in Keene. And Mr. Producer and I, we commute in every morning. We don't go 101. I don't like 101. Too many small towns. It's not the way I like to go. So I go 9202-8993 right into Manchester. Our studios are here in northern Manchester in the Mill Yard. So it's an easy trip on a normal day. This morning, though, we were joking for a good portion of the ride. Look how much salt is on the roads. It was like...
I know. It didn't snow. It salted.
It salted last night. But apparently, for good reason, they were dumping the salt on the road. See, this isn't an issue that you're going to see in southern New Hampshire this morning because the roads here are dry. But over that way, the roads were soaking wet. Well, they were icy. And I guess a couple tractor trailers went off the road, took down some power lines and stoddered. So they closed the road down and, you know, we had to detour.
We went four-wheeling.
We detoured on some dirt roads, which was fine because it was, you know, below freezing. But we got to this one point of the dirt road where I yelled out, "It's soft!" I don't know, it was a swamp or something. Anyways, it was so wet that it didn't freeze. So we're... I had Mercedes-Benz four-wheeling through mud.
I was going to get out and push.
At 5 o'clock in the morning. Just what I want to be doing. Anyways, we made it here just in time to get on the air. But it's a Friday, so it's an easy day, not because it's a Friday, but because there was a Republican debate on last night. It was on CNN. Did you watch it? Did you watch it? I did not. Although we listened to it this morning on our long car ride in. Lots of great moments. I was concerned that that it wouldn't be, that the debate last night would be boring. I thought that maybe Donald Trump would have been told to, you know, protect, don't say anything, don't make headlines, just let's let Ted and Marco duke it out like they've been doing in the past few states.
That's not his style.
But it didn't happen.
No.
It was fiery last night, extremely fiery. Some of the best lines. I was concerned that there would be no fighting on the stage because Jeb wasn't there. You know, and in the past at the debates, it's been Jeb and Donald, you know, going after each other. Last night was great. I mean, it was one of the best debates that we've had so far this election cycle. And we've had plenty of them. We've got the best moments, a minute of the best moments from last night. It's going to sound a lot like an episode of The View. Take a listen to this.
Donald claims to care about him. Donald, I understand rules are very hard for you. They're very confusing.
I have his book.
Okay,
Thank you for the book. Go ahead.
Donald, you can get back on your
meds. There's a lot of fun up here tonight, I have to tell you. Thank you for the book.
Donald, relax.
Go ahead. I'm relaxed. You're the basket case. Go ahead. Don't get nervous.
You're the basket case.
Go ahead.
My name is Donald. There's nothing about you that makes anyone nervous.
You're losing so badly.
Gentlemen, gentlemen.
Well, I'm going to ask that my time not be deducted when he's yelling at
you. Take control.
Okay, now.
The latest debate.
I love John Kasich. Wolf, take control. We need to stop this.
I know, right?
That was all John Kasich said last night, actually.
Well, hold on. I'm going to get my answer. He doesn't get to yell at the whole time.
I want to move on. These are the rules.
He called me a liar and interrupted the whole time.
You've had a chance.
Do I not get a response?
You'll get plenty of response. So stand by.
My name was.
I want to talk about ISIS. Right,
oh, Ben Carson.
And the federal government.
Ben Carson pipes in. My name was mentioned. Do I get to say something?
Someone please attack me.
Trying to stay alive over here. It was a pretty fiery debate last night. Is there any doubt that Donald Trump has the nomination won? Not, I mean, come on.
No, I think he's there.
In the only state that he's not leading in right now is Texas. And Ted Cruz is from Texas. But I think that it'll be a close call in Texas between Ted and Donald. But in Florida, Trump is schlonging Rubio, and Rubio's from Florida. In all of the key important states, it's Trump. Is there any doubt that Trump's not going to be the Republican nominee? That I mentioned that soundbite and much of the debate last night sounded like an episode of The View. Did you see, was it Raven Simone, is that her name, from The View? She said she doesn't, obviously, like the rest of the ladies on The View, she doesn't understand the way the political system works. She said, if any Republican gets nominated, I'm moving to another country. Well, Raven, you better book your plane ticket now, because the way our political system works is we do nominate a Republican and a Democrat. We do nominate both. I don't know if she meant that if a Republican wins, but she said if a Republican is nominated. It just goes to show you the stupidity level on the round table of the ladies on The View. And the former president of Mexico is attacking Trump. Do you see this? He actually cussed on TV. He said, I'm not going to pay for that bleeping wall. We're not paying for that bleeping wall. What other presidential candidate in American history has been attacked by the Pope, China, and the Mexican president? What other presidential candidate? Like I said yesterday, the more leaders, the more countries, like Mexico, like China, that are coming out and attacking Donald Trump, to me, that's an endorsement that he should be the president. Is there any doubt that he won't be? 6:16 now on your Friday morning. Jared Goodell with you. It's the 26th of February, Super Tuesday around the corner. On Tuesday, it's March 1. It'll be a huge day. Huge day. A lot of people want to know who votes in Super Tuesday. I've got the list here. You want to hear the list?
Sure.
Do you care? Alabama. Alaska. Alaska will only do the Republican caucus on Tuesday. And then they're a caucus state. Alaska's a caucus state. Arkansas. That's a primary state. Colorado, it's a caucus state. Georgia, Massachusetts, Minnesota is a caucus state. It'll be on Tuesday. Oklahoma, Tennessee, Texas, Vermont, and Virginia.
Wow.
That's, what is that? 10, 11, 12, 12 states voting.
Busy day.
Yeah. Wednesday morning will be, I think that will pretty much seal up the, it won't seal the nomination for any candidate that day. I mean, even if Donald Trump wins everything, he still won't have enough delegates to win the nomination. However, I think that Donald Trump will probably get 10 out of 12, maybe 11 out of 12 on Super Tuesday next week. It's over. It's over. And the boys know that. Marco and Ted know that, which is why they went after Trump last night as hard as they could, especially Marco Rubio. Rubio went after Trump really hard.
So that's the only part of the plan? Just the lines, the interstate competition?
The nice part about the plan, you have many different plans. You'll have competition. You'll have so many different plans.
But now he's repeating himself.
No, I'm not repeating. No.
Good one, Marco.
I don't repeat myself.
You don't repeat yourself.
He's been waiting for that one.
You repeat yourself every day.
I watched him talking about repeating. I watched him repeat himself 5 times 4 weeks ago.
And I saw you repeat yourself 5 times 5 seconds ago.
I watched him. Meltdown on the stage like Trump, I've never seen anybody.
Let's
I thought he came out of
the
swimming pool.
I said, well,
substance.
I see him repeat himself every night. It says 5 things. Everyone's dumb. He's going to make America great
Senator
again.
Rubio.
We're going to win.
Senator
He's
Rubio,
winning in
please.
The polls.
It's all true.
And the lines around the state. Every night. Same thing.
Senator Rubio.
Poor Marco.
Out of control, huh?
Doesn't he look tired? He looks tired. He also always... Marco Rubio, he looks like he just left the dentist chair.
Bunch of time.
Every day he looks like he just left the dentist chair. And I know he broke his tooth once on a Twix bar a couple weeks ago, but he's just got swollen cheeks. He looks like he just got a couple cavities filled. They did both sides of his mouth, and the Novocaine hasn't worn off yet. That's what... Look, we've got more sound bites from last night's 12th Republican debate. There's been 12 of them so far. I remember the first one. In fact, I was at your house, Mr. Producer, for that, and Donald Trump started off the debate season with a zinger that night, and he hasn't let up since. This certainly has been a fun election. I entered talk radio at the perfect time. What am I going to do after the presidential election? Well, Donald Trump will be the president, so there's what we'll do after the presidential election. At 6:20 now on your Friday morning, still lots more to get to, and we'll get to the latest details on this horrific case out of Kansas. We'll do that after the break. 3 people dead, 14 others injured in a horrific shooting last night. The details, it looks like it was workplace violence at this point. We'll get to that after the break. 6:20 now, I'm Jared Goodell, WFEA, good morning.
Want more, Jared? Listen on demand at 1370WFEA.com. Jared Goodell Show continues next. Jared Goodell Show continues next. Jared in the car on FM 99.9 and AM 1370, or get him online at 1370WFEA.com.
Going to pay for that effing wall.
That's Wolf Blitzer from CNN, the moderator of last night's debate. Play it again.
I'm not going to pay for that effing wall.
Well, what he's well, he's Wolf is quoting former Mexican President Vincent Fox, who said in an interview yesterday that he's not going to pay for that. Well, he said the word. They bleeped it out, obviously. This was on Fusion with Jorge Ramos.
I declare, I'm not going to pay for that wall. He should pay for it. He's got the money.
Although, you know what? At last night's debate, Marco Rubio called out Trump. He said, you know, you hire illegal immigrants to work for you. And you know, so who's going to build the wall? You're probably going to hire illegal immigrants. What's wrong with that? Here's what you do. Here, you get all the illegal immigrants together, all 11 million or 13 million or 20 million, however the hell many there are. You get all the illegal immigrants together and you have them build the wall for us. But you have them build the wall on the southern side of the wall so that they, you know, build themselves out of the country. That's what we should do. Then we don't. Nobody has to pay for it. You just use these. People who really owe us a debt. These illegals do owe us a debt. We've been giving them free food, free housing, free Obama cell phones, free health care. They do owe us something, don't they?
I declare, I'm not going to pay for that wall. He should pay for it. He's got the money.
We need the unedited soundbite. Give me the unedited soundbite. We'll just play that. On the air here. 6:26 now. Jared Goodell with you on a Friday morning. More on last night's debate. There's plenty of... I don't know if we have enough hours this morning to get to all the sound bites from last night's 12th GOP debate. We'll get to that. Other stories this morning that are happening as you wake up. There was a horrific tragedy last night in Kansas. This is a tough one to read. A man walked into his place of work, a place called Excel Industries, just about 5 o'clock last night. This is a plant in Heston, Kansas.
They assemble lawnmowers.
Yeah, they make lawnmower products. He walked in there and he apparently had a couple weapons on him and he just began shooting. They actually say that that he did a couple drive-by shootings first. He as he was driving to the his place of work, Excel Industries, he just rolled down his window and shot a man on a street. Luckily, that guy is going to make it. He was shot in the shoulder. A short time later, he was going through an intersection and he fired his weapon, shot a guy in a leg. Then he, continued on his way to his workplace, Excel Industries, and that's where he opened fire. And they say that he just calmly walked in and just began shooting people.
I heard one witness talk about there was an altercation, some yelling.
Yeah.
He thought he heard somebody pounding on desks. Didn't think too much about it. And then...
Three people were killed, 14 others injured. They say 10 of them are in critical condition this morning. Hopefully, all 10 of those are able to pull through. Mr. Producer's son is on school vacation this week, as many kids are in New Hampshire. So he came into the radio station today, and we were just talking about this story during the break, and he says, well, Jared, you're wrong. There was four people killed. And I said, well, actually, it says that there was three. And he goes, well, the shooter was killed. And I said, well, right, but we don't really count the shooter. And he goes, but come on. All lives matter.
Terrorist lives matter.
Is it terrorist lives matter? Well.
Jeez.
So I guess if you count the shooter, 14 people were killed. But in this case, we don't really care about the shooter. His name has been identified, but I don't see any need to glorify or to share his name with you this morning. 6:29 now. Again, three people dead there, 14 others injured, 10 of them critical in Kansas overnight. Our thoughts and prayers with the families there. I don't think we got a chance to get to the story yesterday, but is it in Georgia? There's an employer who is requiring that all of his employees have guns with them at the workplace.
I saw that.
They have to get the training. They have to get the concealed carry permit, but he's providing them with the weapon. He says, with everything that's going on, it just makes sense to have everyone in that workplace armed. If some of these employees at Excel Industries had a weapon last night when they heard this altercation, maybe this gunman would have gotten a couple shots off, but hopefully... more lives would not have been taken. I'm Jared Goodell, WFEA. Good morning.
Goodell Show continues next. Jared is next. Jared in the Car on FM 99.9 and AM 1370. Or get him online at 1370WFEA.com. Want more, Jared? Listen on demand at 1370WFEA.com. Stick around. More Jared is next.
That Raven Simone from what is it, The View? Anybody watch The View anymore? Watching The View is like watching a last night's Republican debate. It's just a bunch of people talking over each other, except it's a bunch of liberals talking over each other, and which is even worse. Raven Simone from The View, she said yesterday that if any Republican gets nominated, that she's leaving. I got the audio soundbite here. Take a listen to this.
My confession for this election is if any Republican gets nominated, I'm going to move to Canada with my entire family.
See ya.
So Beth,
are you really?
I already have my ticket.
Really?
So, no, I literally bought my ticket,
You're
I swear.
You're not a citizen, you know, of Canada.
It's okay, I'll make it. I'll make it. Okay. I'll figure that out.
Citizenship doesn't matter. At least it doesn't here in the United States. I wonder if Canada takes their immigration laws more seriously. You're not, Joy Behar. Well, Raven, you're not a citizen of Canada. It doesn't matter. I'll figure it out. Like all the Latinos have in America.
I'll make it. I'll figure that out.
I'll figure it out.
You're from Canada.
We'll do that. I'll do some kind of job. We'll figure that out.
No, okay.
Find a sanctuary city.
good riddance. See you later, Raven. Have fun. Because, you know, Raven, that some Republican will get nominated. That's how our political process works. I know that, you know, being a liberal and all, you don't know that. You don't understand. You'd think that because you work in journalism and you supposedly are delivering news to millions of Americans every day, that you might understand things better. But look, again, it's The View. Why should I expect more?
Isn't Rosie O'Donnell, isn't she going to leave the country too?
Good.
If Trump gets elected, she's leaving.
All these, as Trump would say, all these fat pigs from The View are leaving the country.
Donald, you can't say that.
This is great. Another reason why Donald Trump should be the next president of the United States of America. 6:36 now. Jared Goodell with you on a Friday morning. Well, look, I'm going to say it like it is. I'm not going to lay off. I'm not going to shy away from saying what should be said. You can find the contact information for management on the website, 1370WFEA.com. I believe it's the top right-hand corner of the website is the contact button. You click that. That's where you send in your email. In fact, today would be a great day to send your hate mail or your complaints to management, because I get a copy of them, and then we use them on Hate Mail Monday. So you could actually, your complaint could actually make it on the airwaves. And by the way, my quote, I believe my quote was, all of these fat pigs from The View leaving the country, if you want to quote me. If not, if you want to go back and get the exact quote with the time code of when I said that, well, here's the great thing. We have the podcast up on the website every day. Plus, we have the video on demand. We also have live video right now, which you can watch. You can actually watch the show happen live, 1370WFEA.com. And you can actually go back and write down, okay, he said that at 38 minutes in. 3810, it just makes it easier for management to find the exact moment that you're complaining about.
Management listens all the time anyways.
I know. I just, more sound bites from the debate last night. The debate was great. The 12th Republican debate was just fantastic last night. I got to get to this story first, though. Remember yesterday, Fish and Game Department in the state released an ice warning. It was asking ice fishermen to be careful if they went out on the ice.
You think?
A headline today on WMUR, ice fishing derby still on, but some wondering why. On the Facebook page of the Meredith Rotary Club Thursday, the hot topic was why the club's ice fishing derby this weekend had not been canceled after heavy rain and warm temperatures. Some people said it was irresponsible to hold the derby on lakes and ponds around the state. You think?
Well, they'd spend too much money on advertising, Jared. They had to go through with it.
You don't need ice to fish. Just get your boats out and go out. Or fish from the shoreline.
I know, right?
Or better yet, do something productive with your day. And don't go ice fishing. Or fishing at all. I never liked fishing. You like fishing?
I don't mind fishing. My son have gone out a couple of... My son's a better fisherman than I am, so that's what I don't like about it.
It seems like a dirty hobby to have. You gotta put a worm on a hook and...
No, it's actually a lot of fun, Jared. You ought to come out with us this summer.
Yeah. Pass.
But I refuse to buy a fishing license.
So you illegally fish?
I illegally fish.
Huh.
Yes. But... I'm waiting for my conversation with the Fish and Game Warden. I'm sure I'll be fine, but I don't feel that I should have to pay $60 to put a fishing pole in the water. Sorry.
Is that how much it is, $60?
I don't know how much it is.
I don't think it's that much. I think it might be $10 or something.
No, it's more than $10.
6:40 now. Last night's 12th Republican debate was fantastic, as I mentioned. There's a moment here where Marco Rubio and Ted Cruz, both of them, they're battling for second. And so what they're trying to do is, to decay Donald Trump's numbers a little bit, to steal some of his voters a bit. So both Rubio and Cruz are attacking Trump. They're not really attacking each other. They're attacking Trump all night last night. Rubio called out Trump at one point for hiring illegal immigrants, and Trump handled it fantastically. Take a listen.
But I also think that if you're going to claim that you're the only one that lifted this into the campaign, that you acknowledge that, for example, you're the only person on the stage that's ever been fined for hiring people to work on your projects illegally. You hired some workers
from
Poland.
No, I'm the only one on the stage that's hired people. You haven't hired anybody. Right?
Oh. In fact, some of the people
I've hired tens of thousands of people over my job.
You've hired 1,000 people
you've
from another company.
You've had nothing but problems
from another
with your
country.
Credit cards, etc.
Let me say, let me finish the statement. This is important.
You haven't hired one person.
Wait a minute.
What did he say about credit cards?
Well, Rubio's had some issues with credit card. Credit cards. I guess he had a Republican National Committee credit card at one point. I guess he did some crazy spending on it.
Bought some new shoes.
Well, I was just thinking that. That's what was making me laugh. I'm thinking, Marco Rubio has a wallet full of credit cards, or in his case, a purse full of credit cards. I know. How much Finger Hut debt does he have? How much Macy's debt does he have? Keep rolling the soundbite.
Workers from Poland, and he had to pay $1 million or so in a judgment.
That's wrong.
For
hire. That's wrong. That's a fact. Totally wrong.
Well, people can look it up. I'm sure people are Googling it right now. Look it up.
Cruz.
Trump, excuse Polish me. Workers. You'll see $1 million for hiring excuse illegal me. Workers on one of his excuse projects. Yeah. Yeah, he did.
Actually, when Rubio said that last night, you know, Donald Trump, you know, Google it. Donald Trump hired, you know, illegals to work on one of his projects, and he got fined $1 million for it. When he said that, Google said they had like a 300% spike in the keyword Donald Trump hires illegals.
Huh.
Rubio's fans, or not so much fans of Rubio, but people on Twitter last night were pointing out that there's this woman who goes to all of the Rubio events. She's a big Rubio fan, and she has a very distinct laugh. She's a scream. And every time Rubio would say something last night, she would scream from the audience. And you could audibly hear her. I mean, you could hear this woman. I thought my mother was loud growing up. My mom's a screamer. This woman can scream.
I'll see if I can find some.
I've got the audio right here.
Oh, you got it.
Yeah. You like this.
So cute. Doesn't get your own ties and your own suit. All right.
There she is.
So cute. Against your own ties and your own suit.
How'd you like to sit next to that?
Oh, God. Yeah. As Trump would say, that person would be taken out of here on a stretcher. I'd like to punch him in the face. 6:43 now.
Jared.
The issue of the Supreme Court justices came up last night. Now, I've been talking about this really since the beginning of the presidential election cycle, how important this election is, not really for the future 4 years or the next 4 years of American history, but for really the next, you know, 20, 30, 40, 50 years of American history, because the next president will likely be nominating, two, maybe three Supreme Court justices, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, she's falling asleep at the State of the Union.
I know, right?
Now, how much longer does she really have? And there's others who are, you know, aging out. So the next president is extremely important to America, because they will be, the next president will be deciding who the defenders of the Constitution will be. You know, will we, if Hillary Clinton's elected president, she's obviously going to nominate liberals to the Supreme Court. We've already got liberals on the Supreme Court. One more, and we've got a liberal majority on the Supreme Court. And there goes the Second Amendment. And then pretty soon there goes the First Amendment. And pretty soon that old piece of paper it's junk. Who needs it? As Jeb would call it, that piece of paper. So this next president is important. The issue of the Supreme Court justices came up last night. And Ben Carson, who is remarkably still in the race, said that if he were president and he were, you know, given the task, or if he had the task of nominating a Supreme Court justice, that he would look at the, quote, fruit salad of someone's life.
As president, I would go through and I would look at what a person's life has been. What have they done in the past? What kind of judgments have they made? What kind of associations do they have? That will tell you a lot more than an interview will tell you. The fruit salad of their life is what I will look at.
How much longer do you think Ben Carson has in the race?
Not much longer.
A fruit salad. I mean, the guy is...
I understand what he's saying, but it's just an odd analogy.
Huh. Ben Carson supporters out there?
Someone please attack me.
Ben Carson last night was, you know, because basically the way that the Republicans have worked out the debate rules at the GOP debates now is, you know, if somebody says your name, you have a chance to respond. So Ben is begging someone to attack me.
Someone
so
attack me, please.
So that I can say something here. Wolf's not calling on me.
This is the typical thing he does on any debate about policy.
One at a time.
He goes right for the outrageous
Governor Kasich, you have the floor. Governor,
I get a response to that.
You will have a response, but I promise Governor Kasich he could respond.
Can somebody attack me, please?
Okay, here.
Sorry, Ben. It's not worth it to attack you. Drop out of the race. Ben Carson should be the next guy to drop out. Then Kasich. And I think Marco Rubio should drop out next. Although the experts, the pundits say that Ted Cruz will be the guy to drop out next. I hope Cruz stays in. I'm praying that Marco Rubio drops out. Although he's the establishment guy and his super PAC Fox News is going to do everything they can to make sure that he stays alive in the race. But good luck staying alive through Super Tuesday, Marco. Get your boots on and walk out of this race.
Boots were made for walking.
At 6:47 now, more after the break. And speaking of illegal immigrants and Marco Rubio, who would love to grant amnesty to illegal immigrants. There was some testimony before a Senate panel this week. A Disney worker who was laid off, he was testifying, and he broke down in tears. He lost his job to illegals. He lost his job to immigrants. And he broke down in tears about it, for good reason. This guy's got a family to support, and he's losing his job to people who are coming here illegally.
And he had to train them.
And yet Marco Rubio is out here saying we should grant amnesty. No wonder why his poll numbers are awful. No wonder why Jeb Bush had the dropout. All these acts of love aren't working. 6:48, I'm Jared Goodell, WFEA, good morning.
Board is clear.
On FM 99.9 and AM 1370, or get him online at 1370WFEA.com. And on demand at 1370WFEA.com. Show continues next. Jared Goodell Show continues next. Jared in the car on FM 99.9 and AM 1370, or get him online at 1370WFEA.com.
One, two, three, four.
6:53 now. Jared Goodell with you on a Friday morning. Finally, Friday. I think I'm finally starting to get over this cold a little bit. Just been lingering for days.
I know, right?
More on last night's 12th GOP debate. Some of the best sound bites. We'll get to more of those. I mentioned this tragedy that happened in Kansas last night, just after 5 o'clock. A guy got in his car and just began driving to his workplace, and he opened fire from his vehicle a couple times, injuring two separate people. And then he went to his workplace, Excel Industries, which is a lawnmower plant. They make lawnmower parts and lawnmowers. And I guess he was screaming at some of his coworkers, and then he opened fire on them and killed three people. He killed three of his coworkers. He injured 14 others, 10 of whom are in critical condition. I mentioned that there's a workplace in Georgia that's making news this week for requiring its workers to carry firearms at the office, and the employer is actually providing the weapons to the employees. Now, this is an insurance office in Georgia. Lance Toland is the owner's name. He says he's determined to equip the dozens of staffers at the aviation insurance company after they obtain the proper training and a concealed carry license. So far, he says that no one at the workplace has dissented to this.
I'm all for that. Actually, there was a gentleman who had a concealed carry permit, carried all the time, and retired. And after he left, everybody kind of looked around and said, they didn't really like it.
Right. They didn't feel safe anymore.
Exactly.
So this boss is he's saying, you, as a condition of your employment, you need to get a concealed carry permit. You need to get firearms training, and I will provide you with a gun. And it's a revolver, I believe.
I don't know
that he's providing to everybody. It's a 410 Judge pistol.
What is that?
Well, look it up.
I don't have one of those yet.
I think that's a great idea. If a couple of these employees in Kansas last night had a gun in their desk or on their body, this tragedy could have been prevented or made to, could have taken less lives.
Never would have happened.
Now, I don't know that you're going to stop the initial shooting from happening. There might be one or two people who are shot, maybe not killed, but who are shot before, somebody with a gun on the premises, takes their gun out. The good guy takes a gun out and fires back. I don't think you're going to prevent death, every death. I don't think you're going to prevent every injury, but you'll certainly help to stop more bloodshed. And eventually, gunmen, they won't go. They won't go to workplaces anymore. They won't go to schools anymore because they'd be afraid that they're going to get shot. And these cowards don't want to get shot.
That's right.
By the way, the gunman was shot and killed.
410 Judge. It's actually a 45 caliber revolver that you can put a 410 shotgun shell in. I like that.
That'll do some damage.
Yeah.
I love this.
I like that.
I shouldn't say this.
Ferris.
They don't let us carry weapons here at the radio, which makes me angry. I think, given the line of work that we do, I think that they should allow us to carry weapons. Ferris has been waiting on the line. Ferris, a friend of the Jared. Where is he calling from today? He's one of our... We need to have a... We have so many... the callers that are regulars who call into the show and just sit on hold forever, they're, you know, eccentric people. We need to have a name for this pack, this group, this club of people who call. Ferris, I think, would be the president of it. Ferris, good morning to you, sir.
Good day. I'm humbled by the promotion to president of those who make the Jared Goodell Show great. The Jared Goodell Show is good, has always been good. But like Jim Collins' book entitled Good to Great, the Jared Goodell Show goes from good to great.
Right.
Who?
Ferris, can you come up with a name? We're up against this break here. Come up with a name for the pack that you'll be president of the zany, eccentric callers. I don't know. We'll come to you after the break,
I'll tell us. I'll do it while watching Fox News Channel. I encourage everybody to keep their radio on the Jared Goodell Show, but look at the Fox News Channel for this little black dress.
I'm Jared Goodell, WFEA. Good morning.
Goodell Show continues next. Or get him online at 1370WFEA.com. Jared, listen on demand at 1370WFEA.com. for Jared is next. Jared Goodell Show continues next.
Begging some more. We got our heads in the
The 12th GOP debate was on last night. If you didn't watch, you missed a good one. Some of the best sound bites. The knockdown dragout. We've got all of the best audio for you this morning. Plus a tragedy in Kansas overnight. The new details that we just learned. It's Friday morning. This is the Jared Goodell Show. What Fox News is reporting on this morning. Well, of course they're reporting on last night's debate, but any idea what Fox News's angle is this morning on last night's debate?
I have no idea.
Any guesses from the peanut gallery? Anyone? Anyone have any ideas? It's Rubio attacked Trump. Rubio calls Trump out. Rubio tells voters to Google Trump's record. Rubio does this. Rubio does that. Rubio is great. We love Rubio.
They do like him.
They love him. They more than like him. They love him. They love him like Bill Clinton loves a new intern.
I watched that debate.
Do you really care about Donald Trump's taxes?
I think it would be interesting, yeah. Well, he's filed for bankruptcy, what, four times?
He has not filed for bankruptcy.
No?
His businesses have filed for... There's a difference.
There you go. It's a difference.
Well, there is a difference. Donald Trump has started hundreds of businesses.
I know, right?
And sometimes businesses fail. Then when they fail, you file bankruptcy. It's what you do. Donald Trump had a great tweet yesterday. You know, because Mitt Romney, Willard, has asked that... Willard has suggested... That's his name.
I know.
Willard has suggested that there is something hiding in Trump's tax returns, that he won't release some. And Donald Trump tweeted out yesterday a pile of papers... it looks to me about 9 or 10 reams of paper stacked up on a desk, which I guess is Donald Trump's tax return. You thought doing your taxes was a pain. And it's Donald Trump next to the stack of paper, and he tweeted out, "Lightweight losing candidate Mitt Romney asks about my tax returns. I have a store that is worth more than him." Does anyone care what Willard has to say? Does anyone care? 7:10 now. Jared Goodell with you on a Friday morning. Finally Friday. It's the 26th of February. Lots going on this morning. We'll get to it all. The big story is last night's 12th GOP debate. Some wonderful sound bites from last night's debate. A lot of attacking happening of Trump. Rubio going after Trump. Cruz going after. We've got 20 debate insults in 1 minute for you right now. Take a listen to this.
This guy's a choke artist and this guy's a liar. Well, you don't know anything about business.
Well, I don't know anything about bankrupting four companies.
Where was Donald? He was firing Dennis Rodman on Celebrity Apprentice.
You should be ashamed of yourself.
If he builds the wall the way he built Trump Towers, he'll be using illegal immigrant labor to do it.
He lied, 100%.
If he hadn't inherited $200 million, you know where Donald Trump would be right now?
No,
watches in Manhattan.
This is another area on which Donald agrees with Hillary Clinton.
I think Bush did a hell of a bad job.
First of all, very few people listen to your radio show. That's the good news.
A lot of these positions that he's now taking are new to him.
When you say crazy zealot, are you talking about you?
You may not be aware of this, Donald, because you don't follow this stuff very closely.
Yeah, I know you're embarrassed. I know you're embarrassed, but keep fighting. Keep swinging, man. Swing for the fences.
I watched him melt down, and I'll tell you, it was one of the saddest things I've ever seen.
You're a lot of fun up here tonight, I have to tell you. Thank you for the book.
Donald, relax.
Go ahead. I'm relaxed.
Who's
the basket case?
Whose radio show was Donald talking about?
I don't know.
Was he talking about us? Nobody listened?
WFEA.
Is he talking about the Jared Goodell show? Was he calling me out? I love Donald calling Trump a basket case. That's a great line. At one point, Marco called out Trump for repeating himself. Repeat Rubio. The robot. called Trump out for repeating himself.
So that's the only part of the plan? Just the lines, the interstate competition? No,
the nice part about the plan, you have many different plans. You'll have competition. You'll have so many different plans.
But now he's repeating himself.
No, I'm not repeating. No. I watched him repeat himself 5 times 4 weeks ago.
And I saw you repeat yourself five times 5 seconds ago.
I watched him. I watched him melt down on the stage like I've never seen anybody.
I thought he came out of the swimming pool.
I said, well,
let's talk about your plan.
I see him repeat himself every night. It says 5 things. Everyone's dumb. He's going to make America great again. We're going to win, win, win. He's winning in the polls. And the lines around the state.
I love it.
I could hear that woman screaming in the background too.
the Rubio woman.
Yes.
He's got the Rubio's got a super fan, and Twitter was blowing up over this last night. Rubio's got this fan that goes to a lot of his events, and she is the loudest screamer. I mean, Bill Clinton's trying to get her number. This is audio from her last night.
The second. So cute. That's against your own ties and your own suit.
Oh, God, imagine being her husband.
Imagine sitting next to that, trying to enjoy the show.
Awful. Obviously a big issue to most people in America right now is the issue of immigration. And last night, immigration came up a lot. You may not have heard, but the former Mexican president... called Donald Trump out yesterday. We'll get to that soundbite in a minute. Speaking of illegals, I've got a local story for you that I have to get to before I forget. We'll get to what the Mexican president said about Donald Trump in a second here. But first, headline. Honduran man guilty of illegally reentering the United States after two previous deportations. Douglas Maya Romero of Honduras pleaded guilty to illegally reentering the United States after having been deported to Honduras multiple times, announced United States Attorney Emily Gray Rice. This guy is in Concord. In Manchester. He's in Manchester. On June 11th of 2015, Douglas Maya Romero appeared at a Manchester office of the New Hampshire DMV. I appreciate that they're calling him a Honduran man and not a New Hampshire man. On June 11th, 2015, the illegal appeared at a Manchester office of the DMV and attempted to obtain a New Hampshire driver's license. Maya Romero applied for the license using a... Any guesses what the next words will be? A...
Fishing license?
False identity.
No, Jared.
And possessed documents that purported to be a birth certificate establishing his birth in... Any guess where? Puerto Rico! A certified driving record from the DOT in Puerto Rico, a driver's license issued in Puerto Rico, and a social security card issued in the name of a false identity.
Wait, what, do you buy these things? How do you procure those things?
In Puerto Rico, this is the big deal, and this is what, you know, state police and immigration officials have been talking about is that they go to the identity stolen out of Puerto Rico. It's crazy because, you know, Puerto Rico is a U.S. territory. So if you're a citizen of Puerto Rico, you're a United States citizen. So they go to Puerto Rico and they steal identities or they buy identities and then they come here and they get a New Hampshire driver's license with their Puerto Rico identity. A New Hampshire state trooper began questioning the illegal about the documents and sought the assistance of the United States Immigration and Customs Enforcement and Removal Operations Officers. They came and identified the illegal. They took his fingerprints and soon found out his true identity. At that time, the defendant admitted to the officers that his true name was Douglas Maya, that he had previously been deported twice. and that he had come back into the United States. He'd been deported twice, and he came back. He was here in New Hampshire trying to get a license so that he could sideswipe you on the way to work this morning. And you'd be stuck having to make a claim on your insurance because he would be driving without it. How many stories of illegals crashing cars have we heard? And they tend not to carry insurance. And then yours goes up. So obviously the issue of immigration is huge. That's why Donald Trump is doing so well, is now he's talking about immigration and not global warming or free health care. The former Mexican president who has heard about Donald Trump's plan to build a wall and make Mexico pay for it, Vincent Fox, the former Mexican president, went on TV yesterday in an interview and said that he's not paying for Trump's bleeping wall. Here's the audio.
I declare, I'm not going to pay for that wall. He should pay for it. He's got the money.
You've got the money too. Mexico has the money too. All that money you're saving, not having these leeches in your country. Take that money and pay us to build a wall. So that we don't have to keep absorbing your scum.
Watch your time.
The great part of the debate last night was when Wolf Blitzer quoted the Mexican president on saying, I'm not going to pay for that bleeping wall. The Wolf didn't cuss. He was a gentleman about it. He said, effing.
I'm not going to pay for that effing wall.
What a great sound. How to get Wolf Blitzer to say something. 7:19 now, Jared Goodell with you on a Friday morning. More sound bites from last night's debate and a laid off Disney worker who testified before a Senate panel this week broke down in tears because his job had been taken from him by an illegal, by an immigrant. We'll get to that after the break. 7:19 now. Hey, don't forget, you can watch the show live. No, listening's great. But don't you want to see me flailing my arms around in anger over illegal immigrants?
There's a lot of flailing going on over there.
Don't you want to see the expression on my face as I talk about a Honduran illegal re-entering the United States twice after being deported, coming to New Hampshire to get a driver's license? Don't you want to see the expression on my face as I read these stories? You can. 1370WFEA.com. You'll see today's live stream link right there. A live video stream link. At 7:20 now, I'm Jared Goodell, WFEA. Good morning.
Listen on demand at 1370 WFEA. Goodell Show continues next. Or get him online at 1370WFEA.com.
Friday morning, it's the 26th of February. I'm getting all these messages from listeners. Jared, how could we not talking about the criminal record that this guy in Kansas has? I came in over the wire at 7 o'clock this morning. I got it here. I planned to get to it. I just, look, gosh, well, Mr. Producer, he's useless. He's not feeding me this information, you know? He's in there eating Cheetos. But yes, if you just woke up, if you're just joining us, good morning to you. There was a horrific shooting last night this was in Kansas, and three people were killed. 14 others were injured, 10 of them critically. A crazed guy, a guy who is a criminal. And, you know, As we were talking about this during the 7 o'clock news during the break, we were discussing how to talk about this story. The facts are that this guy is an African American, and I said should we say that he's an African American? The shooter who killed three people in Kansas last night at his place of work. He's an African-American. Should we say that he's an African-American? We debated it. And the answer is yes, we should. Because if the guy was white, the headline today would be, "White gunman opens fire at his place of work." That's what the headline would be. So why isn't the headline this morning, "Black gunman opens fire at workplace"? Is that racism in the media? Is the media afraid to say that the guy is black? Are they afraid of being called racist? Or do they have motives at play here? I hate to politicize a tragedy, and I'm not. I'm just telling you why I am going to tell you the race of the shooter, because that has become commonplace in American media to share the race of the shooter when he's white. But I am going to be, I'm going to be,
did you get some shots?
I'm going to be honest and upfront with you, and I'm going to be somebody who is consistent. And whenever these tragedies happen, whether it's a white man or a black man or a Muslim man or a terrorist, a jihadist, I'm going to say who the person is and who the person was. The man who shot and killed three of his coworkers last night was an African-American man. He was a criminal, a career criminal. He has multiple burglary convictions. He has a conviction for grand theft auto. He has a conviction for fleeing from police. He has aggravated fleeing and eluding convictions. And he has a prowling conviction. The media, the mainstream media, will not tell you that today. The mainstream media is going to make this about guns in the workplace. This is workplace violence. This is why we need more gun control. You've got the media is parading around these coworkers this morning at this plant, the Excel Industries plant in Heston, Kansas. They're parading around and showing videos of hurting coworkers, obviously, who just watched some of their coworkers be shot in front of them. They are showing this video of crying people, and they should be showing that. And what they want is to get your emotions going. They want you to feel sad and bad, and you should feel sad and bad. And after you start feeling sad and bad, they will start guilting you into thinking that we need more gun regulations. We don't need more gun regulations. What we need is more guns in the workplace. We need more guns in the hands of these people at Excel Industries. So when a crazed gunman, whether it's one of their own or some crazy jihadist on the street, when somebody walks in, they can defend themselves. Watch carefully how the media talks about this story today. An African-American man. That's what the headline should read, because if it was a white man, the headline would be white man. I'm Jared Goodell, WFEA. Good morning.
Want more, Jared? Listen on demand at 1370WFEA.com. Stick around. More Jared is next. The Jared Goodell Show continues next. Jared is next. FM 99.9 and AM 1370, or get him online at 1370WFEA.com. Jared. Listen on demand at 1370WFEA.com. Jared Goodell Show continues next. Jared Goodell Show continues next. Jared in the car on FM 99.9 and AM 1370, or get him online at 1370WFEA.com. Goodell Show continues next. Jared in the Car on FM 99.9 and AM 1370. Or get him online at 1370WFEA.com. More Jared? Listen on demand at 1370WFEA.com. Stick around. More Jared is next.
Responded correctly in every way, but at some points they were just all talking over each other. It was like watching an episode of The View. Take a listen to this.
Donald claims to care
about him. But he sent me his book with his autograph.
Donald, I understand rules
Mr.
are very
Trump,
hard
you're doing
for you. They're
a great
very confusing.
Job. I have his book.
Okay,
yeah,
that,
on a reality
that,
TV show. Not him.
Thank you. Donald, thank you for the book,
Donald.
Thank you for the book. Go ahead,
Donald. You can get back on your meds now.
A lot of fun tonight. I have to tell you. Thank you for the book.
Donald, relax.
Go ahead. I'm relaxed. You're the basket case. Go ahead. Go ahead. Don't get nervous. Go ahead.
My name
I promise
is,
you,
my
Donald,
name
there is nothing about
I've
you,
seen
that,
you.
That makes anyone
I've
nervous.
You're
you
losing
people
so
are
badly
actually
watching this.
Okay.
You don't know what's happening.
Gentlemen.
Wolf, I'm going to ask that my time not be deducted
this.
When he's yelling at
me. Control.
Okay, now.
The latest debate,
gentlemen,
please.
Hold on, I'm going to get my answer. He doesn't get to yell at
me. I want
to
move on. These are the rules.
Excuse me, he called me a liar and then interrupted the whole time.
You had a chance.
Do I not get a response?
You'll get plenty of response, so stand by.
My name was
I want to talk about ISIS right now and the federal government.
Have you watched The View lately? I know the answer to that question is probably no.
it's not on the top of my list, Jared.
But that's what they sound like. Except they're liberals. So it's even worse. Oh, talking over each other, it's awful. Who do you think will go out next, Carson or Kasich?
Carson.
Yeah.
Although he did say he's gonna, you know, I'm staying in it for the long haul.
Yeah. Well, that's what Carly Fiorina told me the day before she dropped out too. So.
Well.
Ben was begging last. I mean, Ben, his campaign is on its last leg. He was begging last night for somebody on that stage, Trump or Cruz or Rubio, to attack him.
Somebody, I mean, please attack me.
Literally, he was begging. Literally.
This is the typical thing he does on any debate about policy.
One at a time.
He goes right for the outrageous.
Governor Kasich, you have the floor. Governor,
I get a response to that.
You will have a response, but I promise Governor Kasich he could respond.
Can somebody attack me, please?
Okay, here, Wolf.
That's great.
There's something.
All right, so you're betting Cruz drops out next. I would agree with you. I think it's sorry, not Cruz. Carson drops out next, and then Kasich obviously is next, and then who would be after that? I'm hoping it's Marco, but I fear it could be Ted Cruz. If Ted Cruz loses his home state of Texas, he's done.
Yeah, toast.
He's done.
But I like Rubio's shoes. He's fun. He's fun to pick on his shoes.
Rubio's looking. I mean, he's looking. I mean, have you seen him? Did you see him in the debate last night? He looked. I don't know. His color was off.
Well,
he's not looking good.
Being on a campaign trail has got to be brutal. You know, day
awful.
After day after day. Right. How many hours of sleep do you think those guys get a night?
No, they say Trump only gets 3 hours.
Well, that's the Donald because he's a Superman.
It has got to be tiring. I remember when after McCain left the campaign trail the last time he ran, he you've got Secret Service, so you're traveling in a bubble, which has got to be tiring in and of itself. You can't do anything for yourself. He said the first day that, you know, after the election, the first day that he didn't have Secret Service protection, that he went to a Starbucks. He walked there himself, he said, and he said it was great. It was liberating. You get to walk there yourself, first of all, and you don't have reporters following you around. You don't have a bunch of Secret Service agents surrounding it. But you're right. It has got to be tiring. I don't know if I could do it. I think the only thing that keeps these guys alive is their ego.
Exactly. I was just going to say that. You know, and laying awake in bed and wondering at night, being angry, Bernie Sanders.
And I know this has been talked about. It's been said before. But if you look at the pictures, you know, you do the comparisons of, you know, presidents when the day they took office and the day they left office.
Right.
I mean, it ages them so quickly. So quickly. I mean, could you imagine if Hillary Clinton does become the next president, how old she'll look?
Oh,
I'm trying to think of an old woman that's just awful looking that I could compare it to.
Medusa?
Well, there's an option.
Whoa.
I wasn't going to go that far, but since you direct those complaints at Mr. Producer, okay? I did not. This wasn't Jared that said that.
Jared told me to say that. No, I love to hate Hillary Clinton. I don't trust her at all.
Join the club.
I know, right?
Yeah, it's going to be tough. I mean, look at the pictures. Google a picture of Barack Obama from 2008 and look at him today. I mean, he's aged. He hasn't done anything.
Well, except, play a lot of golf.
Except ruin the country, yeah, and play a lot of golf. But he certainly has aged quickly. 7:46. Now, speaking of joining the club, earlier this morning, is Ferris still on hold?
I think he is.
I'm not sure, but the Jared Goodell Show has done a very good job of attracting an eclectic group of people who tend to call in or who tend to come in here to the radio station. We've got Strung Out Steve, the heroin addict, who's a big fan of the show. I'm not sure why I'm bragging about this. who calls in and sits on hold. He calls us from jail occasionally.
Steve's a good guy.
We've got Strung Out Steve. We've got we had Mark Stewart, the presidential candidate, who was you know, baptizing himself in the Merrimack River in a Speedo. I mean, this guy's no taller than Marco Rubio. He's a garden gnome. He was sitting in honest to God, the day we had Mark Stewart in the studio, he was sitting in the chair. And if you're watching the Jared cam, it's this chair here. And his feet didn't touch the ground. That's how small. Anyway, he puts a Speedo on, short, fat, garden gnome guy. Puts a Speedo on and skinny dips, or as he called it, baptizes himself in the Merrimack River.
Baptized.
And then we've got this guy, Ferris, who refers to himself as Ferris and Friends.
Ferris
and Friend. I think he says his name is Ferris Freud. He calls in. His number is from Connecticut, but he always says he's calling from a different state. It sounds like he maybe might be in an institution. Anyways, Ferris has been the guy lately who's been on hold for the entire show trying to get on. And I suggested in the 6 o'clock hour that Ferris come up with the name of the group that these crazies of the Jared Goodell Show will be lumped into. And I told Ferris he can be the president of the group. Now, if Ferris is still on the line, after all, I've said all of that. Ferris, did you come up with a name for the crazies, Jared's crazy group?
I came up with a list of 10 names, but
quickly.
I came up with them as the eclectic group,
yes.
Not of the crazy.
All right,
however,
okay. Eclectic's
some
fine.
Among us, excuse me for speaking while you're interrupting me. In other words, what I call to say is that some among us are crazy, and I look forward to introducing you to someone you referred to yesterday when I was on.
Yeah.
And that is, you referred to my nurses and doctors. I have, on a three-way, my nurse.
Really?
Well, you're going to love it. This is the greatest radio known to man, okay? I'd like to correct you. You said the Jerry Goodell Show has done a good job of attracting this eclectic group. Correction, bro. You have done a great job. The difference between good and great is one of my main points to you today. And I mentioned it yesterday in a book titled Good to Great by Jim Collins.
Ferris.
Former, what?
We're tight on time here, buddy. What
You're
are the,
always tight on time.
What is the name of the group?
You loosen your time to get the good stuff.
What's the name of the group? I need three names here. Give me the top three.
The dog ate the list. Let me put me on hold if you have to.
Put Ferris on hold.
not yet, but when you have
right
to
now.
We've
got
to
put you on hold right now. We've got to go to
right
break.
Now,
I'm
though.
Sorry, Ferris. It cut him off. 7:49 now.
Got to go to break.
We've got more. We've got more sound bites from the 12th Republican debate last night on CNN. You got Marco Rubio still trying. You've got Fox News still trying to take out Trump. That's not working too well. More sound bites from last night's debate coming up. We're going to get to this story, I promise. I've been teasing this for an hour now. We'll do this right after the break. Guaranteed. A Disney worker testifies before a Senate panel that he lost his job to illegal immigrants. And he broke down crying. This story after the break. This will make you mad. 7:59, I'm Jared Goodell, WFEA. Good morning.
Stick around. More Jared is next. Get Jared in the car on FM 99.9 and AM 1370. Or get him online at 1370WFEA.com. Listen on demand at 1370WFEA.com. Jared Goodell Show continues next. Jared Goodell Show continues next. is next. Get Jared in the car on FM 99.9 and AM 1370. Or get him online at 1370WFEA.com.
Is confused as to why Donald Trump will win the GOP Republican nomination to become the next president of the United States. If anyone is still wondering why, it's because he's talking about immigration. You know that, right? Jared Goodell with you on a Friday morning, the 26th of February. Last night's GOP debate happened. More audio sound bites. We'll get to those coming up. Great night last night. Great sound bites. This election cycle has been great for talk radio, hasn't it?
Love it.
I bring up immigration because this week there was a hearing, a Senate panel hearing, and a man testified in that hearing that he himself had lost his job to a foreign workforce, to immigrants. He worked at Disney for 20 years as an IT professional. His name is Leo Pereiro. He lost his job to immigrants thanks to the H-1B visa program. This is the visa program that Marco Rubio and Ted Cruz, by the way, supported, that allows companies to bring foreign workers to this country really for the sole purpose of working. We've got... How many millions of people do we have right now in America that don't have jobs, who are skilled, who want jobs, who can't get them? Because either an illegal holds it, or you've got companies bringing in immigrants, people bringing in people from other countries to do the jobs. And they keep doing it. It's not getting any better.
Do you see that video of the Carrier air conditioning plant?
I did not.
Well, essentially, they just called a little meeting and laid off 1,400 workers, said we're moving our production facilities to Mexico. Thank you. See ya.
This Disney worker, I've got some sound. We don't have time to play all the sound, but I want to play for you this soundbite where he tells the story of how he was informed by Disney that his job was being taken by a foreign workforce and that he was going to train that foreign workforce.
By a prominent Disney executive. With an excellent review in hand, along with the company announcements of record profits, my mind buzzed with thoughts of promotion or bonus. I walked into a small conference room with about 24 highly respected fellow IT workers. The Disney executive made a harsh announcement to us all. All of you in this room will be losing your jobs in the next 90 days. Your jobs have been given over to a foreign workforce. In the meantime, you will be training your replacements until your jobs are 100% transferred over to them, and if you do not cooperate, you will not receive any severance pay. The only glimmer of hope during that meeting was the announcement that new, more exciting jobs would be opening soon.
And by the way, those jobs never came.
Shocker.
Four people were given new jobs. This guy and many others, not only at Disney, but at companies across the United States, are being told on a daily basis, people who have given their lives, people who have families to fend for, people who have taxes to pay, so that illegals and leeches can continue to have free stuff. People who have worked their butt off are told, your job's being replaced by a foreign, and you're going to train them to do your job. More on this after the break. I'm Jared Goodell, WFEA. Good morning.
Jared Goodell Show continues next. Or get him online at 1370WFEA.com. Jared, listen on demand at 1370WFEA.com. Stick around. More Jared is next. Goodell Show continues next. Jared Goodell Show continues next. Jared in the car on FM 99.9 and AM 1370, or get him online at 1370WFEA.com.
A terrible tragedy in Kansas last night, and the media is failing at reporting the story. Plus, the final GOP debate last night. Donald Trump under attack. We've got the best sound bites. It's Friday morning. This is the Jared Goodell Show. Now, good morning to you. It's Friday morning, finally Friday. Drive-in was a mess this morning. I'm sure that the roads are fine out there right now. Driving in this morning, though, the roadways were quite wet and therefore quite icy because it was below freezing and you know, because it rained a lot, that there's no salt on the roads. So we came across an accident on the way in this morning, Mr. Producer and I, and this was on Route 9. In Stoddard, I guess a tractor-trailer truck had hit a telephone pole, taking some power lines down.
Two of them.
Which is a nightmare, because there's really no other way to get here from there, unless, you know, we backtracked and went 101, coming from the Keene area, by the way. So we didn't do that. we took some of these back, and I'm talking back roads to get around the accident.
About as back as you can get.
And we're talking dirt roads. And thank God, I actually had said, thank God it's freezing because there were ruts, you know, the bottom of my Mercedes-Benz was scraping on these dirt roads because the ruts were so deep. I said, thank God it's freezing because it would be awful for us to have to drive through this mud. Not more than 2 minutes later.
Come around the corner.
And all of a sudden I'm saying, oh no, it's soft. I guess there was a swamp or a marsh.
It flooded out, yeah.
It was so wet that it never froze. So now we're in the C-Class Mercedes, which sits about 4 inches off the ground. Mudbogging.
Mudbogging.
We literally four-wheeled to work today. We made it. It took us a whole lot of extra time, but we made it here. Thank God there was a debate on last night, because we had about 20 minutes of sit-down prep time this morning. You couldn't tell, though. I mean, you couldn't tell. If you've been listening this morning, you have no clue. Because, well, you've got me behind the microphone. And really, what prep is necessary?
You don't need to prep,
no,
Jared.
Not as necessary.
Bah.
We'll get to sound bites from last night's debate. There's a lot of great ones. Actually, see, it's not me. I'm not the reason why I don't need to prep. The reason why I don't need to prep is Donald Trump. Okay? That's why. A great night last night at the debate, and we'll get to the sound bites of that. But there's a more important story, a pressing story, a tragic story that you're waking up to this morning, and that's the story about this gunman in Kansas that killed 3 people, injured 14 others. This guy is crazy. The headline is Kansas gunman kills 3. The headline should be black man. Black Kansas gunman kills 3, injures 14 others. Black Kansas criminal kills 3, injures 14. But that's not the headline. Now, this was a white man who committed this crime, this heinous act. You can bet your bottom dollar his race, the color of his skin, would be in the headline. But for some reason, when it's a jihadist, when it's a Muslim, when the man's name is Mohammed, or when the color of the person's skin who commits these crimes is anything but white, when it's black, the media refuses to tell you about that. I listened to CBS at the top of the hour. Not once did they refer to the color of the man's skin. They would say because it's irrelevant. And by the way, I agree with them. It is irrelevant. But be consistent. Why is it relevant when it's a white man, but not relevant when it's a black man or a Muslim? This is how this tragedy started last night. It happened about 5 o'clock local time. It began in Kansas in a town called Heston. The man, the gunman, the black gunman, who, by the way, has a very lengthy criminal record. Should we go through his rap sheet? Do we have enough time to go through this guy's rap sheet?
Hit some of the greatest hits.
Hold on. The African-American man who killed 3 last night has multiple burglary convictions, has been convicted of grand theft auto, has been convicted of fleeing from police, convicted of aggravated fleeing and eluding, and he's got a prowling conviction as well. He's an angel. An angel.
Well, we should develop a law so he couldn't get his hands on any guns. Develop a gun law.
You mean there's not gun laws already, Mr. Producer, that would stop a criminal from obtaining a weapon?
Well, certainly there's not.
Are you telling me that somebody that has a rap sheet that is so many pages long that it's almost as long as Donald Trump's tax return? Are you telling me that a criminal... A felon can't get his hands on he can get his hands on guns? You telling me there's no law preventing that from happening?
I don't know. How else could he have done it?
All right, so this is how it started. 5 o'clock last night in Heston, Kansas. The guy gets into a car and he's driving to his workplace, and he rolls the window down and shoots a man who's walking on the side of the road. Shot the man in the shoulder. That guy's going to be okay. Shortly after that, while driving down the road, the man again rolled his window down and shot a guy in the leg at an intersection. That guy will be okay. Then he made it to his workplace, Excel Industries, which is a a lawnmower plant. They make lawnmowers and lawnmower parts. So he gets there, and I guess there's some sort of verbal altercation, and then he opens fire, and he starts shooting people, coworkers. He shot a total of 17 people, three of whom died, 14 of whom are injured, 10 are in critical condition. And this is just a nutty story. He apparently used a long gun, which is being reported in the media. The media is, he had a long gun.
I haven't heard assault weapon yet. I have not heard that yet.
Oh, give it a minute. All right, give it another hour. Have you heard his race anywhere but here?
Nope.
I'll get hate mail. I'll get complaints from people who say that I'm being racist for reporting the man's race in the story. You watch.
We'll see Monday. Hate mail Mondays.
It'll be there.
I got a stack of them already.
Speaking of, should we get to these sound bites or should I get to this story? This headline, University of Albany students who claim to be victims of racist attack charged. Should I do this story or should we do...
Yeah, we're on race. Let's keep that ball rolling.
All right, we'll get to the GOP debate sound bites, which are wonderful. We'll get to them after the break. Guaranteed. All right. Headline, University of Albany students who claim to be victims of racist attack are charged. Three black female college students who claim to be victims of an assault by a group of white men and women have been charged themselves. Officials at the University of Albany announced yesterday that the two women, Ariel Aguido and Asha Burwell, have been charged with misdemeanor assault and falsely reporting an incident. The third woman, Alexis Briggs, has been charged with misdemeanor assault. The women, all 20 years old, claim that they were attacked early on the morning of January 30th while riding a bus. They claim that they were called racial slurs and were physically attacked while bystanders looked on. You know, a hate crime. Investigators say a review of multiple videos. Doesn't it suck when there's video evidence? Doesn't that just...
Oh.
Investigators say a review of multiple videos of the incident showed no evidence the women were victims of a crime or subjected to racial slurs. In fact, police said the women were the aggressors, assaulting a 19-year-old white woman. Police said surveillance and cell phone video, as well as eyewitness testimony, contradicted the woman's account. The white men that the women claimed assaulted them were actually trying to break up the fight. So you got these black chicks who are assaulting a young white woman. And you've got these three white guys who jump in to try to save their cracker sister. And guess who gets arrested? The three white guys who were trying to break up the fight. See that crack over there? That crack over there, he was calling me racial slurs and assaulting me. University Police Chief Frank Wiley said in a statement, "You'll love this. I wish we had audio of this. I especially want to point out that what happened on the bus was not a hate crime." Wait a minute. You arrested the three white guys because they allegedly were assaulting and calling a black woman names. You arrested them on hate crime charges, but now when it comes out that's not what happened, but in fact it was a black woman who was attacking a white woman, and the black women who are accusing white men of the hate crime, that's not a hate crime in and of itself? A black woman beating up on a white woman is not a hate crime? But come on, it has to be. If three white dudes beating up on a black chick is a hate crime, how come a black girl beating up on a white girl isn't a hate crime? The incident roiled tensions on campus and garnered extensive media attention, including a sympathetic tweet from Hillary Clinton.
Oh, no.
Who said, quote, "There's no excuse for racism and violence on a college campus." Was she talking about the black on white hate crime or the black on white hate crime? Which one were you talking about, Hillary?
It's all the same thing, Jared.
No, it's not. Just ask Hillary. Just ask Bernie. Just ask the mainstream media. We'll get to the sound bites from last night's GOP debate. Arnie Arneson sent to join us at 8:35 this morning, so you can listen for another 10 minutes or so. Yeah. Well, Arnie Arneson, what she thinks of last night's debate. We'll also ask Arnie what she thinks of this story out of Kansas. If it's just a coincidence that the media is not referring to the shooter's race. We'll ask her that after the break, when we have her on at 8:35 this morning. Hey, don't forget, you can video stream the show, 1370WFEA.com, to do that. I'm Jared Goodell, WFEA. Good morning.
Board is clear.
Break that.
Goodell Show continues next. Or get him online at 1370WFEA.com.
One, two, three, four.
8:24 now. Jared Goodell with you on a finally Friday morning. Last night's GOP debate was wonderful. Did you see the story? The former Mexican president is saying or said yesterday in with crude language that Mexico would not be paying for Donald Trump's wall. This is former Mexican president Vincent Fox saying yesterday that he's not paying for Trump's effing wall. Take a listen.
I declare, I'm not going to pay for that wall. He should pay for it. He's got the money.
That was a debate question last night. You know what Donald Trump's response to that was? The wall just got 10 feet taller. And I think Mexico will pay for it, as they should. After all, they owe us something. We've taken 13 million leeches off their hands. 8:25 now. Dean Prentice, the Jargadell Show sports guy, standing by. Dean, did you watch last night's debate?
I got parts of it.
Really?
I got parts of it. Yeah, I got parts of it. I thought a guy who I'd given no credit to this entire debate season, political season, Ricky Rubio, I thought did okay last night.
Ricky Rubio, that's what you call him.
Yeah.
We call him
Minnesota's point guard's name's Ricky Rubio, so
we call him Repeat Rubio because he tends to have a habit of repeating
until last night, where he exposed your boy to being the biggest repeat guy of them all.
That's different.
How's it different? Here's Donald Trump in a nutshell. I'm gonna build a wall. We're gonna win again. I mean, it's the same thing every single time.
But Donald Trump is talking about, you know, we're gonna win and we're gonna this is what we're gonna do.
But he gives you no policy. He gives you nothing.
Marco Rubio is literally repeating the same speech line. Verbatim.
Trump doesn't say anything. He doesn't say anything.
We've got the audio of Marco Rubio knocking on Donald for repeating himself. This is what Dean's referring to. Take a listen to this.
So that's the only part of the plan? Just the lines?
Ferris is gone.
Nice, Dean, his audio is clipping wicked bad.
You'll have competition. You'll have so many different plans.
But now he's repeating himself.
No, I'm not repeating. No.
Oh, there it is. There's the sound you're referring to, Dean.
And it was great. That was one of the best moments of the political season to this point.
Well, I don't think so on that note.
The Trumpster exposed for never having a plan. He's got a plan, but he just keeps talking about the same. I'm going to build a wall. Mexico's going to pay for it. We're going to win. America's going to be great again. We're going to win. We're winners. I'm a winner. Come on. He's lying about his taxes. An audit has never come up in months. Now, all of a sudden, last night, when he's pressured a little bit, I'm being audited for the 14th straight year. Yeah, sure you are, Donald. He's a liar.
Do you have proof otherwise, Dean, that Donald's not being audited?
Every year?
Yeah.
He'd be the first person in the country to be audited 14 years in a row.
It would not surprise me if Donald Trump is being audited and has been.
Trump guy. He's an idiot.
Dean Prentice with us at 8:27 now on the Jared Goodell Show. Dean, what's going on in the sports world?
Celtics won. That's big news. I know you're not a big sports guy. Celtics winning. Celtics are on a roll. They look good. They beat Milwaukee last night. Kind of gave up a big lead, but then got it back. They did well. Big news in New England, though. On the airwaves everywhere, it's talking about how much Pablo Sandoval weighs. I mean, it's just, it doesn't end. It's all people want to talk about. This Pablo Sandoval came in. You know what? I got an idea for people. Shut up. He's fat. He was fat when he was a three-time World Series winner. He was fat when he won the World Series MVP. Matter of fact, he was more fat then than he is now. Maybe he should gain a little weight, you know, get back to the way he was. I'm a fat guy. I played baseball. I was better fat than I was skinny. So get off his ass and let him play. He had a bad year last year. It happens. It's got nothing to do with his weight.
David Ortiz is a big guy, too. How come they don't knock on him?
Well, David's big, but David's big and kind of thick, but not. He doesn't look real fat. He's, you know, he's 6'5". He's bigger. Pablo's short, stocky, fat guy. I mean, that's just. I mean, he's fat, but he's a good baseball player. He had a bad year last year, and everybody wants to equate it to him being out of shape. But if you look at the facts, the fact is he was bigger in San Francisco. The fact is they signed him as a fat ass for $85 million because he was great while he was fat. He's won 3 World Series. He's been the best performer in the World Series of just about everybody in history other than David Ortiz. He's been great in the World Series. He's won a World Series MVP as a fat guy. Some guys are just better fat than they are not fat. But we're a society that can't accept us fat people unless we're on the radio. So I've had enough of hearing about how fat Pablo Sandoval is. Let him play. See how he is, because he's been at his best as a fat guy.
I just got an email from management. They're correcting my pronunciation of the former Mexican president. Apparently it's Vicente Fox instead of, I've been saying Vincent Fox. Who the hell cares what the guy's name is? I'll Vincent. Hack it up some more. Vicente? Doesn't management have a budget to meet or something? They're worried about how I'm pronouncing some guy's name. Dean, always good to talk with you. I'm Jared Goodell, WFEA. Good morning.
Want more, Jared? Listen on demand at 1370WFEA.com. Stick around. More Jared is next. The Jared Goodell Show continues next. Jared is next. On FM 99.9 and AM 1370, or get him online at 1370WFEA.com. Listen on demand at 1370WFEA.com. Jared Goodell Show continues next. The Jared Goodell Show continues next. Jared in the car on FM 99.9 and AM 1370, or get him online at 1370 WM.
On a Friday morning, finally Friday, how are you? Jared Goodell alongside. Last night's GOP debate, the best of that. Arnie Arneson will join us in just a few minutes to give us her take on the debate last night. Some of the best sound bites, we'll play those for you as well. The Tampa Bay Police Department, they just released a video in the past few days. Talking about, what they did is they took a compilation of the best of moments of the Tampa police wearing their body cams. Because there's been this whole talk about body cams, right? Police officers are shooting people and tasing people and killing people, and they shouldn't be doing that.
Hi, WFEA, how you doing?
But here's the problem.
Hey,
what
hey,
they were
worries.
Able to
it's
do is
we're in the middle of the show here now.
They took all of the audio or the video of the their interactions with people. The Tampa Police Department did, and they made a compilation video which they put on YouTube. I'll try to get that audio for you before the end of the show this morning, because it's gold. It's gold. Police officers sometimes just have to act the way they do because they've got children on the other side who are trying to hit them or kill them. Play that audio for you, hopefully, before the end of the show this morning. If not, we'll definitely have it for Monday. It's 8:37 now. Jared Goodell with you on a Friday morning. Have you heard this audio soundbite of Lindsey Graham talking about Ted Cruz? Let me play this for you.
If you kill Ted Cruz on the floor of the Senate, and the trial was in the Senate, nobody could convict you.
Oh, baby, if you killed Ted Cruz on the floor of the Senate and you tried him on the floor, you couldn't convict him. Imagine if Donald Trump said that. What the outrage would be. He'd be called unhinged by Jeb Bush. Who does Lindsey Graham support? Jeb Bush. Who's unhinged? 8:38 now. Arnie Arneson standing by. Arnie, good morning to you.
Oh, my God. Oh, geez. Jared, look what's happened. Look what's happened. There's no decorum. There's no limits. It's now been a license to say stuff that is so over the top, whether it was Donald Trump saying I could shoot someone and still have, you know, people supporting me. Now you've got Lindsey Graham making the comment about Ted Cruz. I mean, look, nobody likes Ted Cruz. We know it. We know that the conversation about Ted Cruz is that he's a liar and he tries to manipulate outcomes. We know it. But there's no call for what Lindsey did, and it's unfortunate.
Arnie Arneson with this at 8:38 this morning. Did you watch last night's GOP debate, Arnie?
Did I watch it? Well, I tried. You know, I get so exhausted that I ended up turning it off about 15 minutes into it. I there's no conversation. It just gets snarky. I mean, I saw Rubio sort of, you know, give a sucker punch to Donald Trump, but I'm not sure it's going to make any difference. And during the course of the evening, nothing gets discussed, so I get disgusted. So I just decided, you know, we know what it is. It's a fait accompli. And what is more remarkable is that Donald Trump might win Florida and might win Texas.
Might.
What does that say about Rubio and
probably
Cruz? Oh, my God.
Arnie, you say you get bored watching the GOP debate and that they're not talking about anything.
No, I don't get bored. I get disgusted.
Okay, disgusted.
Not bored. Not, boredom is not something, that's not my value. I don't mind boredom. I'm miserable. I'm miserable because I don't hear anything that really sort of speaks to what I think are the issues challenging our country.
So would you rather watch a Democrat debate where they're talking about global warming? Is that what you'd rather be watching, Arnie?
Well, let me tell you why global warming is going to be an issue for a lot of people. If you own property on any of the coastlines, since we're seeing ocean rises going higher, your insurance bill is going to go through the roof, everyone. if you don't believe in global warming, at least understand, watch your insurance bill.
That sounds like...
Who's going to teach you this is going to be the insurance companies, not Arnie, not the facts, but when the insurance company says, hey, Bobola, I'm not insuring you anymore.
Well, I think that the Democrats then should keep their mouth shut, because I think the Democrats would love to see private insurance rates go up. It would give them a good excuse to have public insurance, more government insurance programs.
No, I don't want them to do public insurance. I don't want them. I don't want to insure you. I don't want to insure you anymore. You've run a risk, and the risk is you're going to live on the ocean. The ocean is rising. Don't believe in climate change. That's perfectly fine with me. Just guess what? I'm not insuring you, and either is the insurance company. Mm. Live with the results, sweetheart. Yeah. And if this doesn't teach what global warming is, nothing will.
I still haven't seen the evidence that ocean levels are rising. Anyways, Arnie, I want to move on to this this story that's big this morning out of Kansas. There was a gunman who walked in to his employer, and he shot and killed. Well, he shot 17 people, killed 3 of them. 14 are still alive. 10 of those are in critical condition. I want to ask you. Why? And I've been changing the channels here. I've been listening to radio news this morning, and there seems to be something that is being left out of the reporting out of this Kansas shooting. And I'm not sure if it's political or if it's just an accident, but how come no media is referring to the race of the shooter in Kansas?
Yeah, that's interesting. That's interesting. What was his race?
He was an African-American.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
If it was a white gunman, Arnie, wouldn't they be saying...
Would they say he was a white guy?
Absolutely.
Really? Yeah. Where do you have that proof?
What? Every time there's a shooting that involves a white guy, it's a white man, a Caucasian man, a white man did this. The case in Colorado with the Planned Parenthood guy who shot up the Planned Parenthood facility. The headline was, white man shoots Planned Parenthood.
I have a better descriptor. Was he an Uber driver?
He was not an Uber driver.
Okay, so the Uber driver, what color was he?
He was white, and they described him as white.
They described him as an Uber driver.
They described I read reports where they described him as a white Uber driver.
That's a description not of his color, but basically of his, I guess, his skill set. So what was this guy? My understanding is, didn't he work at one of the? To be honest with you. He worked at one of the facilities. Who knows why people do these things? The fact of the matter is, when people resort to guns, when people don't get the mental health counseling they need, when people decide that this is an activity that is either acceptable in their head, because it's in their head, it's not acceptable to society, these are the results. Is his color a consequence? No. Are the deaths a consequence? Absolutely.
Well, let me ask you this, Arnie. The guy's also doing some research here. The guy has a pages-long rap sheet, this African-American gunman. He has multiple burglary convictions. He has a grand theft auto conviction. He's got a conviction of fleeing from police, an aggravated fleeing and eluding conviction, and a prowling conviction. He's a career criminal, and the media is leaving it out.
Well, that's unfortunate. Because here's when we talked about the Uber driver and all those things, we talked about his portfolio. We did. All right. Now the question is, why didn't they talk about his portfolio with this? And see, to me, the color is not important. What is important is to know, what the hell is this guy's history? And was there any indication that this would become a problem? Did he have a mental health history? Did he have a rap sheet? What was his history? His history is what may be a predictor of who he is. And the problem with the Uber driver is there was no predictor. I mean, this is what's so scary. Here you have a guy with no predictor that kills people and then actually picks people up in between the shootings. And then you have a guy that has a history of criminal activity and also kills people. So what does this say to us, Jared? What do we look for? I don't even know what to look for anymore.
Let me
ask
you this.
It's not the color. It's not the driver. It's not the rap sheet. It's whatever inspired them to decide to kill people. That's what's terrifying in this country.
Let me ask you this, Arnie. Do we need better gun control laws so that criminals with rap sheets and felony convictions can't get their hands on guns?
I suspect so.
Do you know that we already have those laws in place?
Well, then the question is, how come they can buy guns at gun shows and nobody asks them those questions? How come they can have private sales? You know
they,
what I
They
know.
Don't buy them. They steal the guns.
No, they do. They can buy them. They can just buy them. The problem is that the loopholes in the laws are as big as the laws. And when you have loopholes as big, then there is no law. If you don't have any enforcement, then there is no law. And that's been part of the problem, not only with guns, but even with what happens with Wall Street and what happens with regulators. When there's no enforcement, then guess what? There are no results.
Arnie Arneson with us at 8:45 on the Jared Goodell Show. Arnie, before we let you go, I do want to get your take on this story.
I'm really angry at Lindsey Graham, so I'm with you on this one. I'm really angry at Lindsey Graham. So on this one, sweetheart, we're absolutely bonding. I just want to make sure you understood that.
I know, Arnie. We might. We got to have a conversation. I got to come up and see you.
Jared. Yeah, one of us has to go into therapy.
It's odd.
I injured my knee. Blade.
All right, so Arnie, I got to ask you about this story, which is one that got me fired up this morning. This week there was a hearing. It was a Senate panel hearing, the Senate Subcommittee on Immigration and the National Interest, and there was a Disney worker who testified that he had worked for Disney for 20 years as an IT worker, and he walked into work one day and he was called in. A group of these IT workers were called in to the boss's office, and the boss gave them their reviews, and they all had glowing reviews. And he said that Disney had record earnings, and they were thinking great things. And then the boss says, oh, and by the way, all of your jobs are going to be replaced by foreign workers that we're bringing in, and you've got 90 days to work, and during those 90 days, you're going to you're going to train them.
I know. Ask Donald Trump about that, because it turns out that most of the workers that work at one of his resorts in Florida are from Romania. Now, you tell me what it is about their skill set that he has to bring them in from Romania, and now you're telling me about this.
But Arnie, it's not about what is being done. It's why is this continuing to happen? Why do we continue to have these stories? And why are people like Ted Cruz and Marco Rubio supporting the H-1B visa programs? How come our government is making it legal for this to happen?
But technically, if you can show that someone has the skill set here, you can't use the H-1 visa. What did I just say to you, Jared? There is no enforcement. There is no enforcement. What he just described is illegal. But the fact of the matter is they were able to somehow manipulate the system and bring someone in under an H-1 visa when you clearly know that there's someone skilled and available here because they've been doing the job for 20 years. That's the problem. When you have a law and it ain't enforced, it ain't a law.
Arnie Arneson with this at 8:47. Arnie, do you think that we should enforce the law?
Absolutely. This should be criminal, and it undermines everything that everyone says that we don't have a skilled workforce. We do. We just don't hire them.
All right, 8:48 now. Arnie, always good to talk with you. Have a great weekend. Next week, we'll be talking to Arnie, I'm sure, quite a bit as we head into Super Tuesday on Tuesday, March 1st. You got 12 different states who will be voting. And my guess is that Donald Trump will win 11 of those states. I don't think he'll win Texas. I think Ted Cruz will take Texas, but I think Trump has 11 of the 12 states. The real question, though, is, how many tiebreakers will Hillary Clinton win in those 12 states? She's 7-for-7 so far. And there's a few caucus states on Tuesday. What if there's ties? Will Hillary win them all? Place your bets. It's 8:48 now. I'm Jared Bell, WFEA. Good morning.
Jared Goodell Show continues next. Or get him online at 1370WFEA.com. Jared, listen on demand at 1370WFEA.com. Stick around. More Jared is next.
I want 2, 3, 4.
And don't forget, the racist Oscars are on Sunday. If you're on your deathbed, well, it's probably a good thing to go out on, watching the Oscars. Anybody watch the Oscars? Which do you think has a better chance of getting a bigger audience, the Oscars or Democratic debate?
The View.
The View. Wow. Now, the racist Oscars run. Are you watching the... Will, Mr. Producer, will your wife be watching the red carpet coverage of those crackers walking down?
I bet my wife will. She'll be critiquing the dresses and how much cleavage. Yes. Yes, my wife is a big Oscars fan. She loves the movies.
Is she a racist?
I think she has white guilt.
Me too. From the vibrations of my privileged white vocal cords with you on a Friday morning, Jared Goodell with you. I should say from my privileged white vocal cords. Other things going on this weekend. There's a ice fishing derby in New Hampshire.
What could possibly go wrong with that, Jared?
WMUR headline this morning, ice fishing derby on, but some wondering why. My question, where's the ice?
Yeah, why not just a fishing derby?
It's 8:55 now. Oh, this is another victim of global warming ice fishing derbies.
Takes a hit.
8:55 now. Last night's Republican debate was on. Let's play one more. Let's play this soundbite. This is some of the best insults from last night's GOP debate in 1 minute. Take a listen.
This guy's a choke artist, and this guy's a liar. Well, you don't know anything about business.
Well, I don't know anything about bankrupting four companies.
Where was Donald? He was firing Dennis Rodman on Celebrity Apprentice.
You should be ashamed of yourself.
If he builds the wall the way he built Trump Towers, he'll be using illegal immigrant labor to do it.
He lied, 100%.
If he hadn't inherited $200 million, you know where Donald
Trump would be right now?
Watches in Manhattan.
This is another area on which Donald agrees with Hillary Clinton.
I think Bush did a
hell
of a good
job.
First of all, very few people listen to your radio show. That's the good news.
A lot of he's talking about our show, by the way.
When you say crazy zealot, are you talking about you?
You may not be aware of this, Donald, because you don't follow all this stuff very closely.
Yeah, I know you're embarrassed. I know you're embarrassed, but keep fighting. Keep swinging, man. Swing for the fences.
I watched him melt down, and I'll tell you, it was one of the saddest things I've ever seen.
We had a lot of fun up here tonight, I have to tell you. Thank you for the book.
Donald, relax.
Go ahead. I'm relaxed. You're the basket case.
You're the basket case. Isolate that. I want to be able to use that. You're the basket case line.
and nobody listens to the radio station anyways.
Yeah, let's get that one too. I want those.
Classic stuff.
Marco Rubio had a fan in the audience last night who was breaking Twitter. She was screaming a lot. She has a very distinct scream. Actually, she's been heard at several Marco Rubio events. This is her scream. And we are now hearing word that actually she was not screaming for Marco Rubio, but instead she Bill Clinton was sitting next to her. That's why she was screaming. She was trying to get away. One more soundbite from last night. Ben Carson was asked, how he would choose a nominee for the Supreme Court. This is what his awkward answer was.
As president, I would go through and I would look at what a person's life has been. What have they done in the past? What kind of judgments have they made? What kind of associations do they have? That will tell you a lot more than an interview will tell you. The fruit salad of their life is what I will look at.
The fruit salad of their life.
There you go.
That will be his dying quote. That it will be the legacy of Ben Carson right there, is the fruit salad of his life. It's 8:58 now. Man, what a fun morning it's been. Hey, we'll be back with you next week, bright and early Monday morning. We'll be previewing Super Tuesday, I'm sure, on Tuesday. Super Tuesday, 12 states heading to their polling locations or their caucus locations to send one of the biggest messages to the nation on who the nominees for the President of the United States might be come this November. I think we will know. Come Wednesday morning, who the nominees will be. Not officially, but it will be clear. And don't forget, if you have Jared, if you're jonesing for me over the weekend, 1370wfea.com for the video podcasts or the podcasts, all there. Good morning.